So remember there were some questions for speakers that we had to unfortunately cut at that time. So yeah, you can start with those questions.
I would ask if Microsoft would be willing to open the data they are collecting for social good.
I think some of the data collecting, certainly we can do that. There is sensitivity with some of the data, for example, the driver facing stuff, especially our data metro, people are violating rules. And if you put the data out there, there could be some issues. So, you know, we've been talking to Jawar and sort of how we can find a balance. But, you know, GPS traces, I mean, we're collecting GPS, other initial data and so on. We can certainly, I mean, we've shared some of it with our academic partners we are working with, but we can do a lot of things down the road.
Because I think there are a lot of interesting problems which probably a broader community can help, and especially extracting the context, you know, trying to stitch the data coming from the other camera and other sensors and, you know, trying to make a context out of it.
Right, right. In fact, I didn't touch on this, but, you know, we have other projects looking at sort of external cameras, you know, traffic cameras and so on, and you can combine the two, right? So you could try to see external view, internal sensors and so on.
Question for Venkat. I'm just curious, does it mute out the voices inside?
Yes, yeah. We don't collect
because
at all.
That could also be a source of context.
Right, it would be a source of a lot of context, but including employees, because these are employee cabs. And so we made sure that we don't collect that, yeah. Yeah, so, I was trying to say that in response to one of the questions. So since we're using standard smartphone cameras, we do need a certain level of light. Now, it turns out if you do data collection at night, the street lights that occasionally illuminate the driver's face are good enough to pick out what we not need. But if it's pitch dark, then obviously these cameras are not going to work. So we've been playing with these FLIR sensors, which are kind of expensive, about $150, that attach to a smartphone and give you pretty good images using thermal imaging. So that's what we would do in a sort of complete pitch dark condition. Today's phones, of course, don't have that sensor, but you know, a few years down the road, those might become part of phones as well.
So this is the
directed towards all of you, I guess. Part of the application space that you're considering is towards individuals, but part of it is policy oriented. So it's really trying to impact policy. In this space, transportation space, how easy is it to impact policy? Is this going to be a huge hurdle? Is this something where you already have ongoing relationships so that it's not going to be as difficult?
Yeah, so regarding this, I can specify one of our work. So if you look into this transport in, say, the semi-urban cities, say we have experimented over Durgapur. So what we have seen that because of this kind of rapid urbanization, you get certain kind of demands from some location. So because of that, what happens that, well, people want a bus stop there, and they just raise their hands, stop the buses there, get up, and that thing. So what we have tried to do, we have tried to figure out all those positions and try to characterize them, like is it a kind of regular phenomena or some kind of, it is just once in a blue moon. So based on that, we can possibly find out that, well, people are demanding a new bus stop here, or there is certain demand for the person based on some kind of rapid urbanization, which can possibly one direction for this policy enforcement.
I don't know enough of the context of India in able to respond to your question. But I think more broadly on that sphere of, I think there are a lot of opportunities, but the opportunities need to be created. Because in any of these domains, whether it's transport or any of the other, it's a turf. It's somebody's turf that you're trying to enter. And in terms of that, to try and engage, and policymaker is very broad, that term. It's not just the government official. You want to engage with the transportation specialists, have them on their team, on your team, because they are the ones that open the doors. So, I mean, for example, in certain cases, we have a parallel track, right? You know, in certain cases, I still haven't fully convinced the transportation specialist, but I'm talking to the government and I'll say, oh, I already have this transportation specialist that he's part of the team, right? I mean, those kind of, to make that strategy of engagement strategy with the policy domain, that's something that one needs to think about and then it's very context specific, but at the same time, there's certain generalizable things that one needs to do. Rather than saying that, you know, I'm this expert. Actually, I'm not an expert, but you know, I do have experts saying, and I think this is useful transportation policy without any frame of reference.
I think it's a very good question. You know, from our viewpoint in the HEMS project, we have talked to policymakers at various levels, you know, the head of traffic in Bangalore and head of BMTC and so on. And those conversations are good, they're pleasant, but they don't really lead to results. So I think, because, you know, you can't change the system. I guess this is being recorded, is it? Okay, so actually, I will re-say it. So you we've had good conversations with them, but, you know, you can't start top-down. So you have to sort of start at the bottom and move up. So what we're trying to do with IDTR is improve driver training. You know, IDTR is a recruiting ground for Ola and Uber. They hire their drivers from there. So if you can show that drivers trained with this our device are doing better, that'll be good. They're also getting what's called an ERTO, which is a licensing setup that uses the same track or a sort of adjacent track. So we can then get into licensing. And then eventually we can have, we can go to the government and say, look, we have shown this. So I think you have to sort of leverage partners who have government connections and start small and grow big.
One aspect here is, if you think about modeling traffic, it's like we are talking about applications here, but if you think about modeling real traffic in Indian cities, that will perhaps benefit in policy making, like where you need to divert the traffic, which part of the time, and office hours, non-office hours, where you need to make a new road, new street. So those things you can discover once you model it in realistically in the Indian scenario. Most of the state-of-the-art models that you have that is not applicable because Indian scenarios are very, very strange. So you cannot have this kind of state-of-the-art models kind of use. So that is kind of one important task.
Question?
I
had a question here. So, I had a question. Actually, I was hoping to hear some talk on what can be done at the smart city kind of level. Suppose if you have cameras at traffic lights, and it's happening in Bombay and Bangalore also, sensors on the roads and a few more sensors which we deem useful. Because now, you know, because of smart cities, the field is slightly open. So at this point, if we can come up with ideas on what set of sensors and data collections we can have, and consequently, what can you do with that kind of data? So if we can, if the panelists can think about some interesting problems that can be enabled and what kind of sensors we should set up, if we had full freedom, because this is supposed to be a research panel, right? So currently, you are all working under the limitations of what can be done under your scope.
Yeah, I guess maybe I can slightly add to that question is, so one model that we can think of is, there are cities like Bangalore, Delhi, already well established and probably not that well planned. And we can think about solutions to improve them, like having bus transit systems. On the other hand, we have new cities coming up where we have a much larger landscape to play with. And so maybe we can comment on how those approaches would look like and whether there are any benefits or disadvantages with either of these ways of thinking.
I actually don't think I have a good answer, but we have one thread of work where we are doing lane level analysis of roads. That is not just what is the traffic flow, but within the lanes, what is the traffic patterns. For that, we actually need external data. So
that is the question you are asking. What is the kind of data? Where should we recommend sensors to be set up, and what can be done?
Okay. So at least the work that we have done actually is basically assumes that each vehicle itself is given the sensor, right? So each vehicle itself is given the sensor and it communicates to other vehicles and it is able to give information on.
That's not scalable, right? I mean, yeah. Suppose that it's a smart city.
Yeah.
I mean, your question is so broad. When you think about a smart city is not just about transport or it's a lot of other things too. It's about health, it's about But I think so. Let me try and limit my answer to maybe one thing in terms of transport, etc. You want to have, you know, and where you're, it's basically greenfield, if that's the scenario that you're giving, then, you know, you don't have any background context of where people are actually coming from, etc. It's now people are going to be living there and coming. That's the context.
No, yeah.
Okay, so then I need to have a very sort of near real-time analysis of where people are coming from, what routes are being taken. Then if you really want to have an intelligent system, I need to be able to ideally do dynamic pricing, depending on the sort of, you know, of routes of people coming into the city. But then I also want to develop my public transport system efficiently. Again, you want to have sensors to be able to sort of understand origin, destination, sources, sinks in real time and feed into that whole process. But one of the sort of cutting edge stuff that, you know, one you can do is you can think about, you know, dynamic routing, right? You know, when there are sort of, you know, there's heavy rain, you know, this is where you need to send your taxis to. And you can think about unique public-private partnerships from all this data that is being gathered from not just the Ubers and Olas of this world, but also from the public infrastructure that is there.
Just to add to his point, I think one thing is traffic signal lights. So right now it is all static, but I think if you have the sensors there, I think we can make them dynamic. So that's an interesting problem for sure.
Actually, I was going to touch on that. So and it also illustrates the problem, right? The Bangalore traffic lights are all networked. We actually talked to some people. They're all networked. But there is manual override, where the local person can override it, and they often do that. So I think I personally don't think smart cities will be completely, you know, fresh efforts which can leave behind legacy. They have to be incremental things. You know, also, different people have different takes on what a smart city means. You know, a neighbor of mine works at Cisco, and I asked him, he's saying they're doing smart city. For them, smart city is just putting Wi-Fi access points at various places, right? So, right. So I think, you know, camera sensors are everywhere. You can think of the whole thing as a control system where the cameras sense. You derive intelligence from that, and then you control. So all the pieces are there. The signals, at least in Bangalore, are networked. There's a central place where you can push out policy. There is cameras, lots of cameras around the city and so on. But I think, you know, stringing everything together and making the whole thing work is more than a technology challenge. I think there'll be resistance. People will not like it. So I think we'll have to solve some of those problems. You can solve the technology. You can construct, control systems, people can model the whole thing and say this is how it should be done. This is when this light should be turned green and that should be, all that can be done. But I think people have to go along, they have to sort of not do the override, I mean, all those things, right? So I think that's where I see the challenges.
Yeah, just a small thing to add. So for this type of problem, a question many of the time I face that whether it is really a technical problem or a some kind of rules and regulation enforcing problem. So people keep on saying that, well, this chaotic move, chaotic transport, abrupt lane change, these are, you cannot solve it technically. The technology is still there, but you have to have some kind of strict regulations or strict rules to solve that. So
in some ways, like, you know, with what Venkat is doing, I think it's helping, right, in spite of people wanting to behave chaotically, if they know that they are being monitored, they will do.
Exactly, I mean, some kind of, yeah.
Monitoring can be enforced with, say, cameras on traffic lights, and if you can do handoff of license plates like the way you do of mobile towers based on camera.
I mean, a bit of that is already happening in many Indian cities, right? You can get traffic tickets now,
yes,
taken by these cameras, and they will catch you 3 months later because, you know, your license plate match. So, I think, what I think is, you know, you have to think hard about which of these can be deployed in a way where they will succeed despite resistance, despite tendency of people to work around the system and so on. So that's all I
have. Maybe we take one final question, and then our speaker Abdul is here. So then we have a quick 5-minute talk before we break.
Yeah. So I just had this one question that we are talking about the application and so on. So do you really talk to the users before you deploy the system? Because typically what we have observed is, human beings always tend to find a solution to problem. They would not wait for all of us to come and solve the problem. They would have their own ways to it. So that's my first question. Do we really observe them maybe not all the time talk to users, but say observe how they are using the current ecosystem, how they are solving their problem and adapting to our solutions, whatever we are proposing. That's one. And if not, do you, that's the second question. If not, do you think that some of the insights that you got after evaluating it, some of the challenges that you observed it, could have been solved before if you had observed them before?
I mean, when you say user, I presume you don't mean just end users. You're talking about your...
Your target users, I'm talking about.
I mean, for example, for the driver training thing, right? Ultimately, the drivers are the ones being trained. But the people we're talking to are the trainers and the institution that is doing the training. And they believe they need tools. And so we are working with them. The final answer of whether drivers benefited and so on is still out in the future. We have not answered that question yet. But I just want to make sure that users don't just always mean the end user. It also means people who find use for what you're doing. Like the traffic police could be your user, but the end user being caught is the average driver, right? So I think that's slightly different. Yeah.
Here, I would like to focus on the public transport commuters. So we did an extensive survey. Like a 2 month survey, we designed a form and asked them to fill up. And my comment is, at least in our part, like Kolkata and other places, those regions, public transport in a very miserable state. So there are only few private owners there, and they're running those buses for their own benefit. So that's why there's kind of huge competition going on between those bus drivers. So that's why whenever there's nobody in the bus stop or there's some kind of competition, they can skip bus stop, whereas there can be a rush driving, and there is no display, and there is no announcement system, and that actually makes the life of the commuters miserable. So when they want to get down a crowded bus, they need to ask people, okay, where this place? If you're in an unknown city, so if you ride a bus, if you board a bus, and if you want to go to a destination, how do you know how long it should take, and when it should get down? So this is a kind of a huge problem for the public commuters. So public transport, at least in one short, it's a kind of miserable state. So you need assistance. You need a huge assistance. And if you have a good public transport system, you can substantially reduce the private cars and traffic in general, if everybody avails public transport. So that's needed.